This video is brought to you by NordPass. This is the best Mac I've ever had. It is the cheapest Mac I've ever had. It is the fastest, most reliable laptop, and I'm selling it. Let me give you some context. Prior to the M1 transition, I've always used the largest of MacBooks because of the obvious reasons: thermals, ports, and better specs. My first true Mac upgrade came around 2018 when I managed to trade in an iMac I had and a lower tier MacBook Pro for an almost maxed out at the time i9 2TB MacBook model. Where I live, the spec cost $6,700. Insane. Keep in mind that my trade-in was for a used machine with those specs. Nevertheless, I felt the luckiest person on earth because once I got it, I could finally unleash my creativity and kill it when it comes to video editing and graphic work. Here comes November 2020, and Apple launches the M1 processor shelved in this very classic yet outdated 13-inch body. This was the moment when my $6,700 machine dropped to a price of around $1,700. The path was clear. Once I purchased the first 8GB model and then the 16GB M1 MacBook Pro that I've been using for almost a year, I saw my productivity skyrocketing while preserving my lap from third-degree burns, and here's why. It didn't take me long to realize that the specs of the past, where we talk about a bunch of gigabytes of RAM and gigahertz, does not apply to the M1 because for the first time, my Mac was able to catch up with my workflow. After years of admiring the colors of the beach ball, I was shocked at how quickly I can open graphic apps, move around layers of projects, color grade, create endless compound clips, produce magical intros, and even occasionally play some games. Many of which, by the way, are done while unplugged, and all of this was thanks to a machine that can be easily explained.
Hey dude.
Yeah.
What computer do you use?
I use the late 2019 Intel i7 AMD Radeon Pro 5500M 16-inch MacBook Pro.
Why? What computer do you use?
Me? The M1 MacBook Pro. Portability, to be honest, was not something that I was after when purchasing the M1, but for a lack of a better choice, I was stuck with this smaller form factor, or so I thought that I was stuck. Quite the opposite. To this day, I'm still amazed that all the aforementioned power comes in such a small, cute, and coat-to-the-touch and lap package that I can easily fit into any of my favorite slings or backpacks, and sometimes even forget that I have a computer with me. This M1 is easier to carry and lighter feeling than my iPad Pro with a keyboard folio, which is even more ironic when you consider that this is in fact my Pro laptop slash workstation that I might forget somewhere by accident because it's that small. Of course, power and size are obvious here, but what is more inconspicuous, and I think it is the secret ingredient of Apple's MasterChef's recipe, is the stability and the overall polished performance. I'm not talking about the fact that, you know, I can open the lid or close it without the MacBook flinching with the external monitor plugged in, or the fact that waking up the laptop is instant, but I'm referring to the seamless integration of hardware and software and how stable everything is. I never had to worry which apps are Intel-based because Rosetta translates them, you know, behind the curtains. And I never had to think if something will run fine or, you know, perform as expected because why wouldn't it? The world was shocked at the overall performance of these, you know, compact machines. And I have to be honest, since winter is coming, I am concerned as to how I'm going to keep my legs warm without Intel inside. Oh, I almost forgot to talk about the battery because honestly, since I moved to this laptop, I totally dismissed in my mind, you know, the status icon of the battery. Seriously, in the rare occasions when I would glance at the battery, it wouldn't be from a position of concern, something that in recent years is turning into a worldwide anxiety problem, but rather from a position of curiosity and joy when I see that I'm still at 90% few hours later. Since purchasing this laptop, I genuinely don't know where my original charger is because I juice it up from the monitor and the rest of the time I don't plug it in. and that might last days if I'm not doing some intensive edits or gaming. So when it comes to charging habits, system stability, user experience, portability, and, you know, sheer power, I could say that my life is now different, better, longer, and I'm not saying this in an exaggerated way, you know, just to sound dramatic, but because it's true. If something saves me an hour or two a day, and that is a time that I can spend with my kids, I'd buy it right away. And talking about price, $1,500 to $1,700 for a laptop that can pretty much do anything and last, you know, a long time is a no-brainer if you ask me. $1,700 is what my depreciated i9 Intel laptop was sold for before I purchased this M1. An Intel laptop that was supposed to be a more powerful pro machine, yet one that plugged in could barely catch up with this light breezy M1. In reality, there are compromises that I had to live through, you know, with this little guy. For example, I didn't go for a larger storage option because I knew that these laptops are transitional models and Apple will soon come out with more pro-grade M1 machines like they did. For that reason, I went for a 512 gigabytes of storage, which meant that I had to learn and live with an external drive only when it comes to video editing. Not a big deal if you ask me, and a great solution for people who prefer to save money on storage because storage is always too expensive. The next compromise, if I can call it that, was the single monitor support because these M1 machines are not capable of running two displays at the same time. And talking about displays, the two Thunderbolt ports were probably the most annoying thing for me. Of course, portability came with the natural downside of a smaller screen too, which is not ideal when doing video or graphic work on the go, but again, I found solutions for everything, like the Thunderbolt dock that I'm using on my desk, and using my iPad as a second monitor for both the on-the-go sessions and on my desk. So with all those downsides in mind, I'm moving back to a larger MacBook Pro, which I placed an order for. And since I plan to stick for a while with this soon-to-arrive 16-inch machine, I did invest more when it comes to specs, and that is the reason that I will part ways with my beloved 13-inch M1. The reason that I'm switching is not earth-shattering or unexpected, but as I mentioned, the potential of squeezing more free time from daily processes like rendering, waiting time, you know, export holds and others is compelling enough for me to make the jump. That and the fact that the 13-inch M1 was a transitional step from the get-go. I do need to plan on how I will move over my content to the new laptop, and as before, I plan on making a new and updated how I set up a new Mac video, which last time was warmly welcomed by tens of thousands of you. If you're interested, subscribe to the channel and turn on the bell notifications so that you get notified when that drops in. In the meantime, an essential item from my transition checklist that I began working on in preparation for the new machine are all my passwords. As someone who constantly preaches to relatives to stop using, for example, Facebook for logins because, you know, Facebook accounts often get hacked, exposing and giving roadmap to hackers, I prefer to use NordPass as a great tool to organize and share the most valuable credentials and payment information. Aside from being an easy-to-use multi-platform password manager, NordPass encrypts all the vault data locally with the XCHA-20 encryption algorithm to ensure complete security, avoiding leaking personal information, credit card details, delivery addresses, or even identity theft. I'm currently on the path of consolidating and replacing all my old breached accounts using NordPass's data breach scanner find, and I wanted to share with you NordPass's Cyber Month deal that will get you 70% off plus an additional free month by visiting nordpass.com/ThisIsE or by simply following the first link in the description below and using the coupon code ThisIsE. To be completely honest, I didn't feel like making a computer upgrade at this time of the year, and I was secretly hoping that Apple wouldn't release something radical until maybe, you know, next year. Yet they did. The new XDR displays, the return of the ports for the most part, and the sheer power and bandwidth of the beefed up M1 processors are everything a creative person can ask for, hence the reason for my upgrade. I assume I will shave off more time as I establish new workflows and procedures, and maybe even improve those YouTube videos as I try to step up the game, you know, each time, quality-wise, storytelling, aesthetics, animations with each new video. And the current M1 that I have, as great as it is, it does hiccup on occasions. But if there were no new MacBooks on the horizon, I wouldn't feel stuck. And I'd keep crushing it with this little portable gem. Amazing laptop is all I could say, and I'm pretty sure the next owner will be just as happy as I am. If you enjoyed this video, you might find my MacBook playlist useful, where I have some great guides and how-to content. Also, if you have any questions, feel free to list them in the comment section below or ping me on Twitter. As always, it's been an absolute pleasure. This is E, over and out.